Okay, today I will speak about the temporality of traumatism, temporality in traumatism from a phenomenological perspective. First of all, I would like to give you a short outline of the presentation. I will start with some introductory remarks. Then I will investigate four characteristics of trauma. After that, I will emphasize and critically discuss the role of the future in trauma. And if I will have time, and that's not, we cannot take it for granted, I will try to refer to work of art, Carracci's work of art, Perseus beheading Medusa. And this work of art could be seen as paradigmatic example to treat traumatism, in my view. I would like to, as a introductory remark, will be very short. I am convinced that it's essential to consider also traumatism from a clinical perspective in order to shed light on some basic notions of subjectivity in the context of contemporary continental philosophy. As you know, Levinas, Derrida define the subjectivity as such as traumatized. That's why if we, it's difficult to understand the concept of subjectivity in Levinas without the understanding of traumatism. And on the other hand, I noticed that there is the tendency to work on traumatism without a very accurate, sophisticated concept of subjectivity. Especially in clinical psychiatry, it's usually that the notion of subjectivity is so problematic that it's not, it's a little bit neglected. This concept of this analysis of traumatism takes place in a previous theoretical framework, especially developed in the context of Husserl's time philosophy. I start from the assumption that there is a plurality of time, of inner time consciousness. This is a very questionable perspective if we try to be loyal to Husserl. Husserl has developed a different paradigm in order to understand the inner time consciousness as an intertwining between primary impression, retention and protention, but even if he developed different paradigms, he was convinced that time consciousness remains the same in all different experiences. I think that psychopathological analysis shows that the inner time consciousness varies in the different experiences. If you consider the temporality in depression or in the temporality in schizophrenia, you can see that the relation between a primary impression and protention and retention may vary. And it's also very complicated to define these terms, because they are very equivocal, but I start from the assumption that there is a plurality of inner time consciousness. So these are, they are the two introductory remarks. And then I would like to start with the second part, and it will be probably the most accurate part of the presentation. And I would like to focus on four characteristics of traumatism. My analysis is strongly influenced by Judith Herman's seminal book, Trauma and Recovery. And Judith Herman understands traumatism in the light of three major characteristics: intrusion, numbing or constriction, and hyperarousal. I deviate from her paradigm. I think that's important to make a distinction between numbing and dissociative tendencies. In her book, doesn't make this distinction. I think it's quite relevant. And then I don't use the term hyperarousal. I use the term hypervigilance in order also to emphasize more the phenomenological aspect. It's important from the very beginning to say that the traumatism, methodological remark, I speak of characteristics and not of symptoms. This is for me very important because according to the phenomenological tradition, especially the German and the French one, it's not appropriate to speak of symptoms in the context of psychopathology. The psychopathological disturbances cannot be reduced to biological symptoms. The term symptom in a medical context has a specific semiotic status. It is a sign referring to an occurring process that is not immediately visible. So we could say the feeling of not feeling is a sign of depression. This perspective implies an inferential process. We can infer the objective existence of a disease in terms of a pathological dysfunction to which we have not direct access from the manifestation of several symptoms. And this is absolutely not the case for psychopathological disturbances. The feeling of no feeling is a manifestation of depression. If there is no feeling of no feeling, there is no depression. That's why you cannot say that this is a symptom of depression. If there is no intrusion, no sense of intrusion, no numbing, no hypervigilance, there is no traumatism. There are not symptoms of a psychopathological condition, but there are the integral parts and moments of the psychopathological disorder. I hope it's clear. That's why I emphasized four characteristics and not symptoms. Then the second point is about trauma and terror. I think Judith Herman is right in emphasizing the fact that terror lies at the bottom of trauma. And from phenomenological perspective, it's very interesting that terror signifies the collapse of intentionality. If you really experience terror, you are not able to intentionally refer to the overwhelming other. Lacan speaks about le real, but you can use different paradigms. Blumenberg speaks of the absolutism reality, but there is something that is so overwhelming that you cannot relate to. One can take very different examples. I was thinking of Lacan's encounter with this giant mantis. But then I took the decision to take another example from one of the most terrifying experiences. And I'm referring to the selection during in the concentration camps. In his book, The Order of Terror, Wolfgang Sofsky describes two main forms of selection. The first involves a parade of naked prisoners who are examined by those who see that verify if they are fit enough to be useful. And the second The second type of selection is a different form. There is the designated person walks around them, and he decides their fate. And it's very interesting to read the reports from the survivors of these selections. Also in the context of the contemporary biopolitical accounts, I think of Agamben and several other authors who, in my view, overemphasize the passivity of the inmates. I think it's important to be aware of the fact that even in the most horrible circumstances, the subjectivity is able to keep a specific form of agency and initiative. And Agamben overemphasize the passivity of the Muslim. And I would like to read this very impressive account written by a Greek inmate. And as we read it together, the inmate is Siegfried Rebilas. Could you read it? Yes? I have a problem with, okay, so I can read. The worst moment is when the person responsible for the selections falls on him. When it comes to life or death, when one waits for a wink of the finger of the world that determines whether one will die or stay alive. When the person responsible for the selection came toward us, none of us knew what to do and how to behave. Should you boldly return his murderous glance, which normally meant that you could say goodbye to life? Or should you lower your eyes and avoid his? Should you even plead for pity back with your eyes of mercy, implore him for the gift of one's life? Because sometimes it was the right decision if you stared insolently right at them, straight into the criminal face. And other times it was the wrong thing to do. But who could look into their minds? It was an internal mental measuring of strength, much worse and more difficult than any fight at the front. And it left in us ineradicable deep marks and incurable emotional trauma. I think I was in the sixth row of this roll call when they came up to me and apparently remained calm, as if I didn't mind my future fate, but my legs were trembling. I felt fear, as once in Auschwitz. I was completely conscious. It was clear to me that my fate, hanging in the balance, was being decided that very second. Suddenly, everything around me started to whirl. I glanced briefly into his eyes, then to the ground, looked once again at the SS men who were facing me. I felt their glance boring into my depth. My throat congealed, seemed as though paralyzed. For a moment, I didn't know what was happening around me, whether their eyes were still upon me, if they were even still standing there right in front of me. I can't say what went inside my brain, but then, not sure when, the world had me back again. If you read this text, it's clear that there is this kind of incredible tension, and then he's not able any longer to stand this tension. And there is a kind of blackout. It's not total blackout because he was able to stand, otherwise he would be likely chosen for selection, but he cannot see any longer. He lost the control of the situation. He doesn't see anything. And this is really a kind of collapse of intentionality, of the intentional relation to the world, actually also to the others and to himself. I think this is the starting point. I don't want to deepen the problem of the intrusion. It's enough to say that post-traumatic events are still present. as it is the first character. It is as if a trauma cannot be separated from the adverb of time still. As you know, they traumatize a person experience different form of memory disturbance, flashbacks, are an example of it. And then flashbacks really show how the past experience is still present. Many times there is a kind of fragmentation of the memory. Veterans experience this overdetermined sensation of the traumatic event, and with an incredible affective power. I don't want to, I think this intrusion, it's a very well-known character. Perhaps it's also important to say from the very beginning that these four characters, characteristics, intrusion, numbing, dissociative tendencies, and hypervigilance, there are also an overlap between them. This distinction have a more regulative nature. The second very important aspect is numbing, constriction. The traumatized person feel detached, emotionally detached from the surrounding. They have the impression not to feel, that they cannot feel anything. They cannot feel any love for the other, for their kids, for the other person. They cannot feel any, they do not have any feeling of engagement and so on. This is also a very important aspect to mention. This aspect is particularly important in order to understand specific behaviors which seem at the beginning quite puzzling, like that traumatized person have the tendency to put themselves in dangerous situation. The very relation to pleasure and unpleasantness changes. And also there is also sometimes the tendency to expose your oneself to the same negative circumstances which caused their trauma. And in this context, there is the very problematic notion of repetition compulsion. Then there are different interpretation from Freud to Janet, but I don't want to go there. I will go to the third essential characteristics, dissociative tendencies. And I think it's important to make this distinction between numbing and dissociative tendencies. Numbing is a defense mechanism, and it fulfills an anesthetizing function. Under extreme circumstances, suffering is so intense that it provokes an alteration of consciousness. Numbing may end in dissociative conditions. One resorts to the extrema ratio of alteration of consciousness in order to attain what is most wanted, being elsewhere. I would like to quote this very impressive passage from Judith Herman, Trauma Recovery. These perceptual changes, combined with a feeling of indifference, emotional detachment, and profound passivity, in which the person relinquishes all initiative and struggle. This altered state of consciousness might be regarded as one of the nature's small mercies, a protection against unbearable pain. A rape survivor described this detached state. I left my body at that point. I was over next to the bed watching this happen. I dissociated from the helplessness. I was standing next to me and there was just this shell on the bed. There was just a feeling of flatness. I was just there. When I repicture the room, I don't picture it from the bed. I picture it from the side of the bed. That's where I was watching from. I would like to quote three different experiences of this dissociative tendency. And then I will discuss different categorical framework in order to understand it. This is an experience of a veteran. Imagine half your mind telling you that you are in a combat zone under attack, that you need to take action to defend yourself, and the other half telling you that that all you need to do is stop and breathe. You don't know what is real and what isn't. Here you could see a very clear dissociative experience. Veteran is in his hometown, and suddenly he experiences this very normal horizon as war theater. And there is an overlap of old reactions and experience over the present. And that there is this kind of, in German, you would say, Ich-Spaltung, in Husserl's term, ego split. And there is this kind of oscillation between a specific past experience and the present one. Another interesting case is the case, Lea's case. This episode took place in the 60s. For example, Lea saw Israeli soldiers pass her window, and she supposed, rightly, that they were bound from her Arab frontier. But at the same time, she knew, the frontier to be closed by an electrically charged barbed wire into which they were to be driven by the Nazi commander. Here, a double consciousness is at work. I think these examples are very interesting for different reasons. You could say here that there is an ego split, if you want to use Husserl's notion, you could speak about representification, also Vergegenwärtigung. And there is this oscillation between the two scenes. It's interesting that Judith Herman referred to Orwell notion of double think in 1984, one of the most important attitudes that the person should learn in order to survive was the exercise of double thinking. Double thinking means the power of holding two contradictory beliefs in one's mind simultaneously and accepting both of them. The person knows in which direction his memories must be altered. He therefore knows that he's playing tricks with reality. But by the exercise of double think, he also satisfies himself that reality is not violated. Then the process has to be conscious, or it would not be carried out with sufficient precision. But it also has to be unconscious, or it would bring with it a feeling of falsity. Even in using the word double think, it's necessary to exercise double think. I think that this reference to Orwell is very suggestive and intriguing, but it's misleading for two different reasons. First of all, it risks equivocation with regard to the relation between perception and linguistic cognition, mediated by social interaction. And secondly, it does not do justice to the specific form of alteration of consciousness in relation to bad faith. As you see, you have seen in the double thinking is actually a process, a mental process dictated by the pressure of environment. Double think is in a way a defense mechanism motivated by the submission to what is commanded by the party. Then you have this suppression of any critical capacity with respect to the authority implies this ability to forget any knowledge about the past. The subject must immediately accept the party's sudden changes in policy. For instance, until a specific moment, one continent was against the other. Then the party says, we hate Oceania, and we love Eurasia. And suddenly all people have to follow these policies, and also to forget the past. In this sense, consciousness must be extremely malleable. But it's important to emphasize the fact that doublethink concerns the alteration of one's knowledge about the world. On the contrary, the alteration of consciousness we have considered about veteran Lia doesn't concern what the person thinks or knows, but it affects what the person sees. His disturbance or her disturbance affects the relation between the act of perception and the intentional act of remembering. It's important in this sense to distinguish with Husserl an act of intuitive consciousness of the present from an intuitive consciousness of the past, remembering. Neither is reducible to acts of symbolic or linguistic thought. They refer to the perceptual world. In the case of the veteran, in the case of Lia, there is an alteration of perception. It's interesting also, we don't have time for this, but it would be very interesting to see how this alteration of perception takes place. Lia sees Israeli soldiers heading towards the Arab border, but the series of these appearances do not relate to Lia's current shared world, intersubjectively shared world. It doesn't refer to this adumbrations, this profile of the perception do not refer to the contemporary world, but rather they are embedded in and continue the post-traumatic situation. As the Nazi commander is right now in charge of closing the border, the past situation is still present. I think it's very interesting to see this kind of simultaneously of two different temporal horizon. And there is this kind of overlap. The Nazi commander is really integral part of her contemporary world. Then I don't have time for the rest, but for the second point, but also I think in doublethink, there is a minimum of bad faith in such sense, as then the person plays trick with reality. And in the case of the veterans of Lia, there is a distorted perception and where the two scenes belonging to this two different temporal horizon overlap. There is no room for bad faith, I would say. Okay. I hope it's more or less clear, this part. Then I would like to consider the fourth part, hypervigilance. And I think it's very interesting to consider this characteristic. Hypervigilance actually refer, if we consider this phenomenon from temporal perspective, hypervigilance refers to the phenomenon of novelty. And novelty is very difficult to define from philosophical perspective, because it refers to the really unstable differential border between the present and the future. The new is the future that is about to become now. And traumatized person have the tendency to see all changes as threats, as beginning of as eruption of a negative event. For this reason, there is an incredible, there is this feeling, this hyperarousal, also from physiological perspective, and it's very important also to emphasize the physiological alteration of the autonomic nervous system. Cardiner defined traumatic neurosis as physio neurosis in this sense. But from a phenomenological perspective, I think it's important to emphasize this hypervigilance. There is this very interesting report by van der Kolk. Van der Kolk is one of the leading experts in traumatism. He's a Dutch psychiatrist. The Rorschach tests also taught us that traumatized people look at the world in a fundamentally different way from other people. For most of us, a man coming down the street is just someone taking a walk. A rape victim, however, may see a person who is about to molest her and go into a panic. A stern school teacher may be an intimidating presence to an average kid. But for a child whose stepfather beats him up, she may represent a torturer and precipitate a rage attack or a terrified cowering in the corner. As you see, Vittorio Gallese wrote interesting paper this year about alteration also of perception of face in traumatized people, of the expression of face. Traumatized person have the tendency to see rage where there is no trace of rage, to see to see dangers where there is no danger. Okay, now I will treat the last part of my presentation, and it's about the role of the future in trauma. I think that it's overlooked in the specialist literature that Derrida, in his work on the attack of the against the Twin Towers, offers an interesting contribution to the understanding of traumatism. His contribution is interesting not only with regard to the temporality, but also with regard to language. I will focus here only on the temporal aspects. And although Derrida does not expressly mention Freud, it is quite evident that Freud is his main polemical target. Derrida's objection against Freud concerned the temporal structure of traumatism, and it could be formulated as follows. Freud's conception of trauma is improperly oriented towards the dimension of the past. On the contrary, it is necessary to point out the essential role of the future in order to understand the terror arising from the traumatic event. Traumatism cannot be seen as an unconscious repetition of an invasive past. So this is his major theory. I would like to read this passage, Derrida's passage. The ordeal of the event has as its tragic correlate not what is presently happening or what has happened in the past, but the precursory signs of what threatens to happen. It is the future that determines the inappropriability of the event, not the present or the past. Or at least if it's the present or the past, it is only insofar as it bears on its body the terrible sign of what might or perhaps will take place, which will be worse than anything that has ever taken place. Let me clarify. We are talking about a trauma and thus an event whose temporality proceeds neither from the now that is present nor from the present that is past, but from an impresentable to come avenir, a weapon wounds and leaves forever open an unconscious scar. But this weapon is terrifying because it comes from the to come, from the future, a future that so radically to come that it resists even the grammar of the future, anterior. Imagine that the Americans and through them the entire world had been told, what has just happened? The spectacular destruction of the two towers, the theatrical but invisible deaths of thousands of people in just a few seconds is an awful thing, a terrible crime, a pain without measure, but it's all over. It won't happen again. There will never again be anything as awful or as more awful than that. I assume that mourning would have been possible in a relatively short period of time. Traumatism is produced by the future, by the to come, by the threat of the wars to come, rather than by an aggression that is over and done with. I think the point is very clear. It says that actually the repetition as a deterror doesn't stem from this repetition, but it's traumatic event disseminates a kind of also unconscious possibilities. It's very clear in the rest of the text that a traumatic event in a way really triggers and disseminates, proliferates negative possibilities which remain unconscious, and this is why the future is so important. I would like to question one basic presupposition of this of Derrida perspective. Is it legitimate to affirm that traumatism is general, is characterized by the primacy of a specific temporal dimension, the future over other dimensions? If we consider the Auschwitz survivor, it's quite clear that the major problem is not the repetition or the future. The problem is not that he is afraid of the fact that the same experience will happen again. On the contrary, the problem of working through the past seems to be the essential one. How is it possible that all this could have happened? And why did it happen to me? I think there are the basic question haunting the survivors. In other cases, I think the future plays a more important role. I think it's not possible to identify one fixed and stable temporal structure which is valid for all form of traumatism. In this sense, it's not also legitimate to affirm the primacy of the future. Each case presents us with an unpredictable singularity where the predominance of either the future or the past varies to a large extent. We can speak about it more on during the discussion. I think that I don't have time to address the last slide. This is a Carracci work, Perseus beheads Medusa. I think that it's a very impressive work of art in Palazzo Farnese in Rome. I think it could be seen as a paradigm for treating the traumatism indirectly. As you see, if we start from the assumption that blindness is an integral part of the terror, I think it's not by chance, any chance, the Medusa is a paradigmatic image of terror. And one cannot look at Medusa directly for the same reason that it's not possible to be aware in the very moment of the traumatism, as we have seen with the Auschwitz survivor. That's why it's possible, one has to address it indirectly, and then also with the help of, here we have Mercury and Minerva, but I think I don't have time to discuss this work of art. And I thank you very much for your attention. I would like to have time for some questions.
Thank you very much, Stefano. I think you can close your share screen. Okay, thanks a lot. Very rich talk. I'm sure we're gonna have plenty of questions. As I ask you, please announce them on the chat, but I will use my privilege now to ask the question first, because otherwise I might not be able to make it, and you can think in the meantime. So it's, your talk reminded me of an early essay by Binswanger on phobia. I can't recall the title at the moment, but there was some phobia in the title. It was very early, 1906, I guess, when he did something similar to the reader, but different. And I was wondering whether you would see something related in the case of trauma. So his argument was, if you have a phobic reaction to something that is based on some experience, the temporal structure, the future is also important in constituting the phobic experience, because there was something, it was a case analysis of a patient, because there is the horizon of the future of the person that preceded the event was in a way constitutive to this event becoming, well, I don't think he used this word traumatic, but maybe. But the point was that temporal structure of, if you translate his argument, and he was criticizing Freud also, that it's not the past that determines the phobic, the content of the phobic reaction. Would something similar could work in here in the temporal structure of trauma along the reader's line, but the future attitude, but in the stage preceding the traumatic event? In other words, wouldn't it be possible, well, you know, the event of the same content, let's put it this way, wouldn't cause a trauma in a person with a different temporal structure at the very onset, or before the traumatic event has happened? So I wonder if you thought about this and whether it would play anywhere in your the model of temporal structure of trauma that you have before this original event, whether it would make sense.
In which sense, before the original event?
Before the traumatic event, would temporality play any role in the constitution of the event as traumatic before the onset of this whole, you know, temporal working that you were talking about? So, like, yeah, I think if you see any option of you know,
I think it's an interesting question. Usually, when I started referring to Levinas, and also if you also consider the notion of difference in Derrida, actually they start from the traumatism. There is this, but also in other contexts, less pronounced, if you consider Waldenfeld's idea of being infected, but in Ricoeur, there is all, in Merleau-Ponty, there is the idea that our experience starts with an affection. We are affected by something which is not object which doesn't have an intentional, reference. We cannot immediately to be contemporaneous with this event. We always came too late. And this is a typical form of traumatism. And the notion of traumatism, as in Charcot and Janet, or later with Freud, is the most important person, but a reference point. But there is this idea that first there is an over-determined event with overwhelming, and in a way we cannot relate to it. And our subjectivity, our self-relation start from this affection and from this being affected. That's why the traumatism is so relevant for several categorical framework of subjectivity in different contexts. I have mentioned Levinas for sure, but also several others. That's why then the point is to which extent our subjectivity, our also temporal consciousness can deal with this negative eruptions, to which extent can we anticipate it? And this is there is this possible vulnerability, exposure to the negative event, but it remains that the traumatic event should keep some radical alterity, that it will always surprise you. But this is actually the problem also of traumatized person who cannot any longer make this distinction between a harmless, innocent event and the eruption of the negative. I think that this is a kind of problem. But thank you for the question.
Thanks a lot. Let me open the chat because I haven't seen no questions yet, as far as I can see. The floor is open. Please announce your question, and it's best if you ask it in person. Constantinos Morphis has one question.
Yeah, thanks. I have a question about the split of the ego. Maybe you can talk about that more. How the double thinking that you're referring to, what does this mean?
Yeah, double thinking is, I think it's a very interesting concept, but it's, I think it's important to consider this, to consider the peculiarity of the ego split. In the three cases I mentioned, there is an alteration of perceptual consciousness. The traumatized person relates to the perceptual horizon in a different terms. He or she does see something different. And also the world constitution is very different. There is this overlap between past experience and present experience, which is not present in double thinking in Orwell sense. In Orwell's in the terror forces the person to assume all information in an uncritical terms. The double thinking really refers only to thinking. It's a kind of uncritical assumption of all possible information. That's why I think this kind of example is relevant in order to emphasize the difference between perceptual consciousness, the difference between perceptual consciousness and thinking or cognitive consciousness, you could say. cognition. And I think that's something very important, a very important contribution of phenomenological tradition is this very careful distinction with regard to the different relation between consciousness and intended object. I think, and actually, if we refer to Derrida, I think one of the major problem of specific reception of Derrida is the lack of knowledge of Husserl's phenomenology. When Derrida speaks about something impresentable, it's not, it doesn't refer to any poetic image. It refers to intentional consciousness in Husserl's sense. So Derrida wrote the first books on Husserl, and he refers all the time to implicitly to Husserl, Heidegger, many others, Benjamin, so on. But I think that's important to emphasize.
Thank you. And we have another question from Michela Summa.
Yeah. Thanks, Stefano. I wanted to ask you which role in your analysis language plays, because at one point you kind of said, well, there is a kind of irreducibility of the experience to language, but on the other hand, implicitly, of course, since you are quoting from testimonies, there are people who are talking about either their present experience or their traumatic experience or their future kind of hypervigilance toward the future and novelty. And I think it's quite clear, or maybe not clear, but I think it's quite understandable that speaking about either of these dimensions represents already a step forward, probably in the direction of dealing with a trauma. But then I wanted to ask you whether you think there might be a relation between the different temporal dimensions that you analyzed and the fact that one speaks about it. And then, of course, the problem of sharing kind of experience, which is not shareable in principle. But when you talk about it, you do that with the attempt of at least to a certain extent. Share it. And of course, if you think about the Shoah, this was also kind of basically moral concern with the necessity of sharing the traumatic experiences. But yeah, general question, what do you think about the role of language?
Yeah, that's this is a very important aspect. I refer to this book, Trauma and Recovery, and in the second part of this of a U-determined book is about the stage of recovery, and she developed a very complex strategy for recovery, and the first step is to create a safe environment, and the person should in a way regain a basic trust in the world, in the other, and to feel safe. And only after that it's possible for the person to remember the traumatic event and to also be exposed to the mourning process. And that remember means also to verbalize it, to address it and to verbalize it. But first of all, you need safety. You need a basic trust in the other. Otherwise, it would be very dangerous for the therapy. And then after the mourning, there is the idea of reconnection, that you can find your old ego before the trauma, rediscover the old interest. And it's a very complex process. But for sure, remembering means also verbalizing the event. And this is a very delicate, especially in therapeutic session, it's a very delicate balance. You have to find a very delicate balance between exposure and because it's there are several defense mechanisms. One of the most immediate is avoidance. And then there is this kind of double bind situation. If you avoid the all confrontation with traumatic event, the situation will get worse and worse. But if you are if you are not cautious, there is also the danger that you will be exposed in a negative terms. That's why you have to find a golden mean in Aristotle sense, and verbalization plays a major role in this. Actually, there are some therapists that when you are able to, after years, to speak of the traumatic event from the third person perspective in a way as in meets terms as a general other, then really means that the traumatic event is has gone in a way. There is a very interesting case, but perhaps there are other questions. I can speak later about it.
Yeah, we got a couple more.
Yeah,
the next person on the list is Evangeline De La Fuente.
Yeah,
would you like to ask the question yourself, or shall I read it?
Oh, please go ahead and read it. Thank you.
Okay. So the question is the following. Can you please give examples of what factors might influence whether it is the past or the future that will be predominant at a given time?
Yeah, thank you. I think it's, first of all, in my remark was of methodological nature. I think there is the tendency to define temporal structures in a very normative and hierarchical terms, which doesn't help to the understanding of the temporal phenomena. But as I just said, it depends really on the lived experience of the patients. If you consider an Auschwitz survivor, it's clear that the problem cannot be of the repetition of the same conditions. This is really not the case. And also, I think one of the most interesting features of Derrida's analysis is this kind of redefinition of unconscious in terms of the future. Usually, especially in psychoanalytical tradition, the future is not the most prominent aspect with regard, especially in Freud's account, with regard to the unconscious. And Derrida says that there is this kind of proliferation of negative possibilities, unconscious negative possibility which destabilize the subject. If we now experience the attack against the Twin Towers, it's possible that something even worse, a nuclear attack, could happen. We never verbalize it, but suddenly these possibilities destabilize our consciousness. And I think in the what I said at the end, you have to really to take into account the singularity of the traumatic case, and in this sense you can see which interrelation between the different temporal horizon are present.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
The next question is more technical. If you could repeat the title of the book you were referring to.
Trauma and Recovery. I think, I don't know which book. I think Trauma and Recovery, Judith Herrmann book. is a very important, is a seminal book in the context of traumatism.
All right, the next question.
Thank you, thank you.
From Saura BH about Husserl.
Yeah, thank you, Professor, for the very interesting lecture. So just a query that how do we understand the event of trauma like through this Husserl's analysis of internal time consciousness? So how do we see trauma like the ability to, because in Husserl, there is a time is experienced through this retention, structure of the retention and potential. So what actually happens at trauma, like I'm not able to like recover the past, or is there an or that happened that I'm not able to anticipate the future because it is too traumatic. So how, where should we locate trauma actually?
Here it's important to make a distinction between Husserl's analysis of a time, inner time consciousness, and the reception. Especially the French phenomenology, if you consider like Levinas and Michel Henry, have emphasized the essential importance of a specific passage in the appendix one of the lecture, time lecture in 95. And it's about the primary, this text refers to the primary impression as creation. And this, the primary impression as originary creation cannot be object of intentional consciousness. It's very interesting that the source of intentional consciousness cannot be object of intentional consciousness. Then the other interpretations which emphasize the impossibility for the consciousness to grasp the retentional continuum. I don't want to become too technical, but I think this idea of primary impression as ungraspable was the link between Husserl and Levinas' interpretation. It's a very strong interpretation. It's a kind of, you could say, over-interpretation, that there is a shift, a paradigmatic a shift of paradigm. That's why you leave Husserl behind you with this interpretation. But I think it's an interesting move. And then you can interpret primary impression more in Levinas' sense as traumatic, but this is beyond Husserl, that's for sure. But it's also possible through Husserl. I think one should be very balanced in this regard in order to articulate the relation between these authors in proper terms.
Thank you.
And the next question from Noshin Agajari.
Yes, thank you. I was wondering if verbalizing and speaking of the traumatic event, does it even, can it play a role not just in healing a trauma, but also in the very form, in the very forming process of trauma? By denying, when speaking of an event is denied by other people, and it cannot find a way to be communicated by other people, can it also produce a trauma which is, I think, different from a subjective trauma, maybe if we can call it an intersubjective trauma? Can it also be a case? Thanks.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. It's very important what you say, and then it's about the basic trust. As if you are, if you live in a pathogenic environment where you cannot verbalize your pain is not accepted or is denied, it's clear that the traumatic disturbance has the tendency to become more profound and more invasive. That's in order to deal with the traumatic event, it's needed that the others and the context is able to recognize it. If the other will not recognize your trauma, this is not a very good starting point to deal with it. That's for sure. That's why I think it's very important that the reaction of the other. There is a very immense literature about it.
Okay, thank you. That was the last question on the list. Anyone else? If not, you can think. I will ask just a short question. So I was wondering about the dissociation as well, and maybe it's an impossible question to answer, but you said that you used this rape example when someone is seeing the body from behind. And I was wondering about the temporal dynamics behind that experience. To what extent this is something that has happened in a given moment in the past, and to what extent it is the function of memory that is in remembrance. And I read some experimental research on how disembodiment functions in remembrance of people who are traumatized, which was empirical. But then what for sure we can say, from what I remember from the paper, this is something that post factum is happening. But is it also something that is original? You know what I mean? To what extent is something original? Is it an original dissociation and disembodiment where you can see from the third person perspective in the traumatizing moment? And to what extent it is a later post factum denial in which the temporal dynamics, which could be created by trauma, was somehow created by trauma itself, by the event itself, also plays a part farther on. So it affects the meaning in this of this disembodiment progressively or not, or I don't know. Well, that's
maybe. Yeah, it's a very difficult question because, you know, it's in this sense, you really have to rely on the reports of the patients. But there are for sure some cases where the person has this disembodied perspective, especially as there are a lot of reports for people during the World War tortured, and they really see the situation from outside. They really are detached. There is also this interesting book, The Little School, Tales of Disappearance and Survival by Alicia Portnoy. And she refers to also to this kind of disembodied experiences during the negative event, let's say. Then that's one of the major problems of traumatic event, that this the limit between reconfiguration and memory is very blurred, and that's. Also, the starting point is that you cannot recall what happens, because even when you were experienced this, you were not present. That's why I really like this example of the Auschwitz survivor, because he cannot remember it because he was not present, really, strictly speaking. That's why there is always a moment of blindness within the terror, and this moment of blindness reflect itself also later on. Yeah. That's why there is something really ungraspable, impresentable, which could be one could fill the gap with imagination. According to Freud, anxiety, as the second theory of Freud, anxiety has the function to in a way to tame the traumatic event. We imagine the future negative situation in the light of traumatic event in order to prepare better for it. But this kind of preparation is not really a kind of accurate report of what we have experienced. There are different forms of projections and imagination. That's why I think it's a very complex process which cannot be disentangled, analyzed in according to rigorous schematic definitions in a way.
Yeah, I think it actually answers the question what you just said, because you could say, well, the entanglement itself, you could say it's the core and what is more or less is secondary to the entanglement.
Yeah.
Michael and Schwartz, please.
Perhaps question. Just one. That's okay. Why I also mentioned different cases, because Leah case was a very different one. She experienced 20 year after the traumatic event and alteration of the perception. It was not during the traumatic event, but after 20 years or 25 years, she experienced a different, a strange overlap between the present horizon and the past situation. I think it's very interesting phenomenological to see from a phenomenological perspective that she was convinced that the present horizon ended in the past horizon, as if it was now, as if it were now. I think it's very interesting in this sense. And that really shows the actuality of the traumatic event. Mm-hmm.
Thanks. We got two more questions. So Michael Schwartz is first on the list. Michael, hello.
Yeah, I have a question based on my experience as a psychiatrist and the new experience of using intravenous ketamine to help people deal with post-traumatic stress disorder. And I'll just give you an example of a man who is about 60 years old, who as a young adult lived in another country. Subsequently, the family emigrated to the United States after there was a revolution, and he had this incredible traumatic experience of helicopters flying over the home he and his family had run away to, and two of his brothers being dropped out of the helicopter, and lived in terror every day with post-traumatic stress. After the ketamine, there was an incredible change in his experience. These memories persisted, but really more as narratives, not as primary driving, anxiety-producing experiences. And there's something in this that I can't really put my hand around, but it's just amazing. The idea about ketamine is that it gets rid of junk memories, memories that are not relevant anymore. And the incredible healing that happened in this particular situation, and many others as well, is something that I think is a really new breakthrough that should be investigated phenomenologically, how that can happen. The same memories are there. They're now like reading a story rather than my own experience. They become narratives, not drama.
I have to admit, I couldn't hear perfectly, but if I understood correctly, you were impressed by the fact that a patient was able to overcome his traumatic event through the work of memory and verbalization. Is it right? Or
no, it was about intravenous ketamine.
Intravenous ketamine.
Okay, I couldn't hear that. Sorry, it was I
just rephrased shortly. Yeah, so okay. What Michael said, this is a mystery which is interesting to investigate. Why, I don't know if it was one shot or how long the treatment was, but the ketamine has this marvelous effect of changing traumatic memories into narratives, which are no longer disturbing. That was his. That was.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. That's. That is in line with also Janet's idea of a kind of regression in traumatism of a very visual and primitive memory. which substitute our narrative memory. And then therapy means the re-establishment of a narrative, which allows us to make sense of our personal life. And I think that's, that is a very essential shift from this fragmentation to a narrative, and then all different methods, as also in this case, the specific therapy, which allows this shift, I think can make a major contribution. I think it's interesting from phenomenological perspective that traumatism really shows that human being is a symbolic animal, and it needs narratives which make sense. And without this kind of narratives, without this kind of reconfiguration of the events in a meaningful terms, there is a kind of collapse of our symbolic identity. In this sense, I think it's it has to do with this. This form of therapy helps the reestablishment of the symbolic identity.
One more question from Camilo Sanchez. Camilo, can you, would you like to add? Oh, you didn't write it, so you have to ask.
Yes, yourself. Thank you.
Yeah.
The question, thank you for the presentation. I hope you haven't answered the question. I would like you to shed some light. Could you please shed some light between the relation of trauma and the body schema?
Yeah, that it depends on which, if you consider Merleau-Ponty idea of body schema, then a traumatic event change means a radical reconfiguration of the whole bodily schema, what I say, I refer to the pleasure, to different relation to pleasure, and unpleasure experiences. The characteristic of numbing is very invasive because people do not feel anything in this sense. They really feel detached from their own interest, from their own family, and this lack of affection has immediately an impact on how one person experience their daily life. That's why it's very well known that addiction, especially alcoholism, drugs addiction, have the mean to compensate on the one hand to escape, to run away from the intrusion of the traumatic events, on the other hand to make the person feel something, feel alive. There is this kind also of tendency. Then if you then it depends how you use body schema. You can also refer to body schema more in terms of habits, and then we have a different problem. But I think I would say especially the problem of the affect plays a major role in this sense. There is a lack of sensitivity to the resonances of the and affordances of the environment and of the relation with the other, which causes causes is too strong, but which provokes puzzling behaviors. Also self-harm and so on.
Thank you very much.
And the next question from from Karen Papelero asking me to read it, so I will. In relation to the forgetfulness of the traumatized individual, van der Kolk also says that, quote, the body keeps the score, end of quote. Would you say that one does not really forget after all? How can we make sense of this phenomenologically?
I referred to this book. Yeah, I think it's accurate to say that the body keeps the score, but it doesn't mean that the body, that the subjectivity is not able to deal with it after a long process. That there is a difference between forgetting the traumatic event and to overcome it. I think there are several examples of successful therapy, but it doesn't mean that there is a total forgetfulness or amnesia. There is an amnesia in terms of that this traumatic event, when you are recovered, this traumatic event doesn't have any strong impact on your daily life. In this sense, there is a forgetfulness, but it doesn't mean that it cannot arise unannounced under specific circumstances. So a vulnerability, the possibility to be exposed to similar circumstances remain there. In this sense, the body doesn't forget it. I think both perspectives should be integrated.
Thanks. Well, we are approaching our end time, but we still have 3 minutes. If anyone would like to comment at the end or ask a short question. Well, if not, thanks a lot. The talk will be posted on our YouTube channel for the others to watch as well. Many thanks to Stefano for the talk, and many thanks to everyone for being here, and hope to see you next time.